Hello, my name is Ken, and welcome to my 32-question quiz about the old American West. And you know, the 1800s wasn't just about cowboys and Indians, outlaws, and saloon fights, because there were some other interesting things, too, that happened during the 1800s. And with all that said, let's get started. Good luck, and here we go. Question 1. Which Old West 1800s wagon train trail is considered to be the most well-known? Is it A, the Santa Fe Trail? Or is it B, the California Trail? Or is it C, the Oregon Trail? Or is it D, the Mormon Pioneer Trail? The answer is C, the Oregon Trail. The first civilian wagon trains started appearing in 1840, and in 1854, a New York newspaper editor named Horace Greeley said these famous words, "Go west, young man, and grow up with the country," and many thousands of pioneers did. And most of those pioneers went by way of wagon trains because the journey west was very harsh and it was very dangerous. And there is some safety in numbers. The very large covered Conestoga wagons were usually pulled by a team of oxen, while the smaller Studebaker covered wagons that were called prairie schooners were usually pulled by either a team of horses or a team of mules. A typical wagon train consisted of about 35 to 40 covered wagons and about 75 to 100 people. There were several well-known wagon trails, but the best-known wagon trail was the Oregon Trail, and it was 2,170 miles long, going from St. Joseph, Missouri to Oregon City, Oregon, and moving along at an average of 12 miles per day. The journey usually took about 6 months. The Oregon Trail has also been called our nation's longest cemetery because of the many people who died during those many wagon train journeys over those many years. In 1869, when the Transcontinental Railroad was completed, wagon trains were no longer needed because people started traveling mostly by railroad. So the wagon trains began to slowly fade away into history. And by 1880, the wagon trains were mostly all gone. Question 2. In what year was gold first discovered in California? Was it A, 1847? Or was it B, 1848? Or was it C, 1849? Or was it D, 1850? The answer is B, 1848. On January the 24th, 1848, a man named James Marshall was building a water-powered sawmill on the banks of the American River, located at the foothills of the Sierra Nevada mountain range, when he discovered a gold nugget. The property was owned by a Mr. John Sutter, and that location would become famously known as Sutter's Mill, California. Within a year, the news of gold being discovered in California traveled all across the United States and even into other countries. And that's what created the famous 1849 gold rush. And it is estimated that there was approximately 300,000 prospectors who poured into California, seeking their fame and their fortune. And yes, it's true, there were some prospectors who did strike it rich, but the majority of the prospectors did not. because all they found was just a lot of hard work with little bitty pay. And many prospectors only found chiggers, ticks, and snake bites, and that was it. It has been estimated that between 1848 and 1855 that there was approximately 750,000 pounds of gold that was discovered in California. And even to this very day, there are still several working gold mines in that part of California. Question 3. In 1859, where was the largest silver deposit discovered in U.S. history and would become known as the Comstock Lode? Was it A, Sutter's Mill, California? Or was it B, Cripple Creek, Colorado Territory? Or was it C, Virginia City, Nevada Territory? Or was it D, Deadwood, Dakota Territory? The answer is C, Virginia City, Nevada Territory. In the 1850s, Virginia City, Nevada Territory was just a very small mining camp with no name, but in 1859, when a large silver deposit was discovered, the small no-name mining camp started quickly growing when thousands of miners and prospectors started coming for the silver, and the town very quickly grew to about 30,000 citizens, and it became a true Wild West town with many saloons, many gambling parlors, and many dancing girls. And there were plenty of gunfights and two-fisted law. The Wild West town supposedly got its name from one of its local drunks who was from Virginia and who the local miners called Old Virginny. And legend has it that one night when Old Virginny was drunk, he busted a bottle of booze and christened the miners' camp Virginia City, and the name stuck. The large silver deposit that would become known as the Comstock Lode was named after one of the local prospectors named Henry Comstock, who had the nickname Old Pancakes and who literally went from rags to riches overnight. It has been estimated that the Comstock Lode has produced approximately 15 million pounds of pure silver and approximately 500,000 pounds of pure gold. And today, there are still several working silver and gold mines in Virginia City, Nevada. Question 4. Making its first 2,000-mile relay ride on April the 3rd, 1860, how long did the Pony Express stay in business? Was it A, 12 months? Or was it B, 18 months? Or was it C, 2 years? Or was it D, 4 years? The answer is B, 18 months. The Pony Express started in St. Joseph, Missouri, and it went 2,000 miles to Sacramento, California. The Pony Express riders changed horses every 2 hours, and a new rider would take over every 75 to 100 miles. The Pony Express horse ride went on 24/7, day and night, and depending on the weather conditions, it usually took about 8 days to get from St. Joseph, Missouri to Sacramento, California. The special made saddlebag that carried the 40 pounds of mail was called a mochila, and a mochila had a padlock on it, so nobody could tamper with the contents. The Pony Express service only lasted 18 months, from April of 1860 to October of 1861, because when the Transcontinental Telegraph was completed in October of 1861, the Pony Express service was no longer needed. So the Pony Express and all of its riders faded into history. Question 5. What years are considered to be the prime years of the American Old Wild West? Was it A, 1800 to 1835? Or was it B, 1835 to 1855? Or was it C, 1855 to 1865? Or was it D, 1865 to 1900? The answer is D, 1865 to 1900. Starting right after the Civil War was over, there was a 35-year period of time of lawlessness that took place in many of the western U.S. territories and even in several of the U.S. states. And that period of time would eventually become known as the American Old Wild West. And it's really too bad that many people have learned their American Western history from watching old Hollywood Western movies that are just chock-a-block full of mistakes. But yes, there really were plenty of bank robberies, train robberies, stagecoach robberies, and plenty of shootouts. But no, according to Western historians, there is no documented proof of any two gunslingers who ever did meet each other out in the street at high noon to see who was the fastest draw. That just never did happen in the real Old West. Question 6. Which firearm was most preferred and used by both lawmen and outlaws during the American Old Wild West? Was it A, Winchester Model 1873 lever action repeating rifle? Or was it B, Colt 45 Model 1873 Army Peacemaker 6-shot pistol? Or was it C, Parker Model 1865 double barrel 12-gauge shotgun? Or was it D, all of the above? The answer is D, all of the above. There were many different manufacturers and different kinds of firearms that were used during the old Wild West, but it's these three firearms that became most famous and the firearms that has been said to have won the Old West are the firearms that tamed the Wild West. But either way, they all played a very important role in our American history. The old 1873 Winchester rifle, also known as a saddle gun, used a 44 caliber bullet, and the rifle held 12 rounds of ammunition. The 1873 Colt Army Peacemaker was a 45 caliber, single-action, 6-shot revolver. And back during the Old West, it was said that God created all men, but it was Samuel Colt who made all men equal. The Model 1865 Parker shotgun came in several different sizes, but the 12-gauge was the most common size. All three of these guns were favorites among the lawmen and the outlaws because of their reliability and their ruggedness. Question 7. Which Western cattle driving trail was the most famous? Was it A, Chisholm Trail? Or was it B, Western Trail? Or was it C, Shawnee Trail? Or was it D, Goodnight Loving Trail? The answer is A, Chisholm Trail. In 1864, a fur trader and merchant named Jesse Chisholm established a trail and trading post from Texas and on across the Red River and on into Oklahoma, Indian Territory. And then starting in 1867, Texas ranchers started using Chisholm's Trail to drive their longhorn cattle from San Antonio, Texas, and onto the railroads in Kansas, where the Texas beef was shipped back east to feed a hungry nation. The Chisholm Trail was approximately 1,000 miles long, and it took on the average about 10 Texas cowboys to move 20,000 head of cattle from San Antonio, Texas to Abilene, Kansas. And at 15 to 20 miles per day, it took about 2 months to get there. As barbed wire fences started getting popular and the railroads started expanding, the cattle drives and all the Texas drover cowboys all faded away into history. Question 8. During the American Old Wild West and on February the 13th, 1866, where did the first daytime bank robbery occur? Was it A, Liberty, Missouri? Or was it B, Dodge City, Kansas? Or was it C, El Paso, Texas? Or was it D, Yuma, Arizona Territory? The answer is A, Liberty, Missouri. And not only was it the very first daytime bank robbery in the American Old Wild West, it was also the very first James Younger Gang bank robbery. And from that Liberty, Missouri bank, the Clay County Savings Association, the outlaw gang took away approximately $60,000 in bonds, paper currency, silver coins, and gold coins. And during the gang's getaway, a short gunfight broke out, and one innocent citizen bystander was accidentally killed. The bank that they robbed in Liberty, Missouri, was located only 12 miles from Jesse and Frank James' farm near Kearney, Missouri. Question 9. Who was the biggest and best known stagecoach builder during the era of the Old West? Was it A, Studebaker? Or was it B, Wells Fargo? Or was it C, Fisher? Or was it D, Abbott Downing? The answer is D, Abbott Downing. Abbott Downing was located in Concord, New Hampshire, and they manufactured over 3,000 stagecoaches during the 1800s, and they were very well known for their high quality and their reliability. And that's why the better known stage lines, like Wells Fargo and the Butterfield Overland, only used Abbott Downing stagecoaches. Studebaker did manufacture a few stagecoaches, but Studebaker was best known for manufacturing covered wagons and horse carriages. There were different sizes of stagecoaches, but the most common used carried 6 passengers and the driver. And if it was good terrain, it was pulled by 4 horses. But if it was rough terrain, it was pulled by 6 horses. Traveling by stagecoach was not cheap, like it is in the old Hollywood Western movies, because on the average, they charged about 10 cents per mile, and that did not include any meals. The stagecoach had to change horses every 2 hours, and on an average day, and in good terrain, a stagecoach could travel about 60 miles in 12 hours. And in some places, they even traveled at nighttime. With the expansion of railroads and the invention of the automobile, the stagecoach faded into history, and the very last stagecoach passenger service happened in Nevada in 1909. Question 10. Who was the first sheriff and the co-founder of the Long Branch Saloon in Dodge City, Kansas? Was it A, Charles E. Bassett, elected sheriff on June the 5th, 1873? Or was it B, Bat Masterson, elected sheriff on November the 6th, 1877? Or was it C, Wyatt Earp, appointed deputy sheriff in 1878? Or was it D, Matthew Matt Dillon, elected marshal in June 1872? The answer is A, Charles E. Bassett. Sheriff Bassett served two terms as the sheriff of Dodge City, Kansas, and since the Kansas Constitution would not allow a third term, the famous lawman, Bat Masterson, won the election by 3 votes on November the 6th, 1877. And then Sheriff Bat Masterson appointed the former sheriff, Sheriff Bassett, as his deputy sheriff. In 1878, the famous lawman, Wyatt Earp, did serve as a deputy sheriff in Dodge City, Kansas, for a short period of time. Oh, and by the way, if any of you out there answered D, U.S. Marshal Matt Dillon, then you really need to go back to school and restudy your history. Because in the real Old West, while the Long Branch Saloon was for real, U.S. Marshal Matt Dillon and Miss Kitty were not. They were fictitious characters on the old TV show Gunsmoke. Back in the 1800s, Dodge City had a bad reputation for being a rough and tough and wild western town. And that's where that old saying started that is still with us today. If you want to be in a place that is safe and peaceful, then you better get out of Dodge. Question 11. During the old Wild West and beginning in 1875, what was the nickname of the most notorious stagecoach robber? Was it A, Dangerous Dapper Don? Or was it B, Fast Firing Fred? Or was it C, Cunning Cowboy Ken? Or was it D, Gentleman Black Bart? The answer is D, Gentleman Black Bart. His real name was Charles Bowles, but he went by the nickname Black Bart because after each stagecoach robbery, he would leave behind at the scene of the crime and inside the empty strongbox that he had robbed some poetry that he wrote, and he would sign it Black Bart. His stagecoach victims said that he was dressed in black, he was very well spoken, he was very well mannered, and he was a real gentleman. Between 1875 and 1883, Black Bart robbed 28 different Wells Fargo stagecoaches in Northern California and in parts of Oregon. But, just like all other criminals, he was eventually caught, and he was sent to the San Quentin prison. During the period of the American Old Wild West, there was a total of 456 stagecoach robberies, and that person who often sat next to the stagecoach driver carried a shotgun, And that term is still with us today, riding shotgun. And there's something else too. That long board where the driver would rest his boots on was called a dashboard, because that board was put there to dash off any mud or horse manure that the horses might be kicking up with their hooves. And that term is also still with us today. The dashboard in your car. And that's how it got its name, the dashboard. Question 12. Which black person was a runaway slave? And in 1875, he went on and became a famous U.S. deputy marshal. Was it A, Frederick Douglass? Or was it B, Nat Turner? Or was it C, Bass Reeves? Or was it D, Booker T. Washington, Jr.? The answer is C, Bass Reeves. In 1875, Bass Reeves was appointed U.S. Deputy Marshal by Judge Isaac Parker, the hanging judge, at Fort Smith, Arkansas. And U.S. Deputy Marshal Bass Reeves became very well known and very famous when he helped clean up the outlaws out of the Indian Territory of Oklahoma. And during his 32 years as a lawman, U.S. Deputy Marshal Bass Reeves killed 14 bad outlaws. And in addition to that, he arrested and brought to justice many hundreds of other outlaws. Question 13. Injured in an 1876 gunfight, which famous Western lawman used a walking stick and wore a derby hat? Was it A, Charles Bassett? Or was it B, Heck Thomas? Or was it C, Virgil Earp? Or was it D, Bat Masterson? The answer is D, Bat Masterson. Before Bat Masterson became a famous lawman, he was a well-known buffalo hunter, a scout, and an Indian fighter when he fought at the Second Battle of Adobe Walls, Texas, in June of 1874. Bat Masterson and 27 other Texas buffalo hunters held off a large force of Comanche Indians. Later on, in January of 1876, when Bat Masterson was only 22 years old, he was in Sweetwater, Texas, when he got into an argument and a gunfight with a soldier over a woman. And during that gunfight, a bullet hit him in the pelvis, and that's why he had to use a walking cane for the rest of his life. And as the years went by and the Western history books were being written, Bat Masterson's walking cane and his derby hat became his trademark and a part of his legend. Question 14. Where did the famous lawman Wild Bill Hickok die on August the 2nd, 1876? Was it A, El Paso, Texas? Or was it B, Deadwood, Dakota Territory? Or was it C, Abilene, Kansas? Or was it D, Tucson, Arizona Territory? The answer is B, Deadwood, Dakota Territory. On August the 2nd, 1876, the very well-known and famous lawman and gambler, James Butler Hickok, better known as Wild Bill Hickok, was playing a game of poker at Saloon Number 10 in Deadwood, a gold mining town in Dakota Territory, when in walked a 24-year-old outlaw gambler by the name of Jack McCall, who was looking to make a name for himself. So he shot Wild Bill Hickok in the back of the head, killing him instantly. A year later, Jack McCall would be tried, found guilty, and hanged for murder. The cards that Wild Bill Hickok was holding in his hand when he was murdered was a pair of aces and a pair of eights. And even to this very day, that particular hand in the game of poker is called a dead man's hand. A pair of black aces and a pair of black eights, spades and clubs. Question 15. Which outlaw gang attempted to rob the First National Bank in Northfield, Minnesota on September the 7th, 1876? Was it A, the Wild Bunch Gang? Or was it B, the Dalton Gang? Or was it C, the James Younger Gang? Or was it D, the Doolin Gang? The answer is C, the James Younger Gang. There were 8 outlaw gang members who were involved in that Northfield, Minnesota bank robbery. Brothers Frank and Jesse James, brothers Cole, Jim, and Bob Younger, and 3 other bad outlaws, Cleo Miller, Bill Stiles, and Charlie Pitts. During the bank robbery, a 7-minute gunfight ensued. And after it was all over, 4 people lay dead. 2 Northfield citizens and 2 outlaws, Miller and Stiles. The other 6 outlaws were wounded but made it out of town. And then several days later, the law caught up with them. And Charlie Pitts was killed in a gunfight. And the 3 younger brothers were captured and were all sent to a Minnesota territorial prison. Frank and Jesse James both got away, but they went on and continued their life of crime. And during that same time period, the Pinkerton Detective Agency was very well known for their abilities and their successes at tracking down and capturing bad outlaws. But they were never able to track down and capture Jesse and Frank James. Question 16. On September the 18th, 1877, in Big Springs, Nebraska, which outlaw committed the largest and the best-known train robbery in the history of the old Wild West? Was it A, Butch Cassidy? Or was it B, Bill Doolin? Or was it C, Cole Younger? Or was it D, Sam Bass? The answer is D, Sam Bass. The 6th member, Sam Bass Texas Outlaw Gang, did most of their train and stagecoach robberies in Texas. But when they robbed the Union Pacific Gold Train in Nebraska in September of 1877, they stole $60,000 in gold, which in today's money would be an equivalent of about $2 million. On July the 19th of 1878, the outlaw gang was going to rob the bank in Round Rock, Texas, but the gang was wiped out when they got into a gunfight with the Texas Rangers. The next day, on July the 20th, a seriously wounded Sam Bass was found in a pasture outside of town, and he was arrested and taken into custody. And then, on the next day, July the 21st, 1878, the bad outlaw Sam Bass died on his 27th birthday. Question 17. Who was the gunfighter known as Billy the Kid? Was it A, William H. Bonney? Or was it B, Billy Clanton? Or was it C, William Stiles? Or was it D, Bill Longley? The answer is A, William H. Bonney. Some historians claim that he was born William Henry McCarty to a poor Irish family in New York City way back in 1859, but later he himself changed his name to an alias, William H. Bonney. But most folks just called him Billy the Kid. Billy the Kid started his life of crime when he was 16 years old, and by the time he was 21 years old, he claimed that he had killed 21 men, one for every year of his life. But his own life ended one night on July the 14th, 1881, when Sheriff Pat Garrett caught up with the Kid on the Pete Maxwell Ranch, located near Fort Sumter, New Mexico. Sheriff Pat Garrett was hiding in a dark room waiting for the Kid. And when the Kid entered the room and said, who is it, in Spanish, Sheriff Garrett recognized the Kid's voice, and the sheriff fired just one shot from his pistol in the dark, hitting the Kid right through the heart and killing him instantly. It was just a lucky shot that started that phrase that is still with us today. It's just a lucky shot in the dark. Question 18. Where did the famous OK Corral gunfight happen? Was it A, Dodge City, Kansas? Or was it B, Tombstone, Arizona? Or was it C, San Antonio, Texas? Or was it D, Tucumcari, New Mexico? The answer is B, Tombstone, Arizona. In Tombstone, Arizona territory, on October the 26th, 1881, three lawmen brothers, Wyatt Earp, Virgil Earp, and Morgan Earp, along with their friend, Doc Holliday, confronted several bad outlaw cowboys in an alleyway that was located very near the OK Corral and livery stable. The gunfight lasted less than 1 minute, and after it was all over and the gun smoke had cleared, three cowboys lay dead on the ground: Frank McClowry, Tom McClowry, and Billy Clanton. And all of the other cowboys took off and got away, and that one very short gunfight made Wyatt Earp one of the most famous lawmen of the Old West. Question 19. Appointed Justice of the Peace in Val Verde County, Texas in 1882, which judge claimed he was the only law west of the Pecos River? Was it A, Judge Isaac C. Parker? Or was it B, Judge Samuel R. Peters? Or was it C, Judge Fantley Roy Bean? Or was it D, Judge James C. Strange? The answer is C, Judge Fantley Roy Bean. In 1882, Judge Roy Bean settled in a small railroad workers' camp called Langtry, Texas, located very near the Rio Grande River and Mexico, where he opened a saloon that he called the Jersey Lily because he was hopelessly in love with a British actress named Lily Langtry, and her stage name was the Jersey Lily. Judge Roy Bean never met the Jersey Lily, but he would very often send Miss Langtry love letters. And one time, she even replied back to him and told Judge Roy Bean that she would like to buy the town of Langtry a new water pump. And Judge Roy Bean replied back to Miss Langtry and told her that he appreciated that offer for a new water pump, but that it would not be necessary because the good citizens of Langtry, Texas, only drank whiskey. Judge Roy Bean used his saloon as his courtroom, and one time he even fined a dead man $40 for carrying a gun, and that $40 fine just happened to be the exact amount of money that that dead man had in his pockets. And there's something else that was funny about Judge Roy Bean. Every time he performed a wedding ceremony, he would end it by saying, "And now I pronounce you husband and wife, and may God have mercy on your souls." Question 20. Which James Gang member outlaw killed Jesse James on April the 3rd, 1882, in St. Joseph, Missouri? Was it A, Sam Bass? Or was it B, Elmer McCurdy? Or was it C, Bob Ford? Or was it D, Bill Anderson? The answer is C, Bob Ford. Jesse James had been running and hiding from the law for a long time, and he had been going by the alias name Thomas Howard. But on April the 3rd, 1882, while he was making plans to rob another bank with two of his gang members, Bob Ford and his brother Charlie Ford, Jesse noticed a picture on the wall in his living room that was crooked. And when Jesse got on a chair to straighten the picture, Bob Ford saw his opportunity to collect the reward money. So he shot Jesse James in the back of the head, killing him instantly. Jesse James was only 34 years old when he left behind his wife, Zerelda, two sons, and a daughter. And years later, there was a popular folk song that came out that talked about the dirty little coward who shot Mr. Howard. Question 21. Which famous female sharpshooter joined up with Buffalo Bill Cody's Wild West show in 1885 and performed her shooting skills for the next 17 years? Was it A, Belle Starr? Or was it B, Martha Jane Canary? Or was it C, Pearl Hart? Or was it D, Annie Oakley? The answer is D, Annie Oakley. Annie Oakley learned to shoot pistols and rifles at a very young age, and she became a world-famous sharpshooter. And even President Teddy Roosevelt once said that Annie Oakley was the best shot in the world. Question 22. Which famous Native American Apache Indian warrior surrendered to the U.S. Army on September the 4th, 1886? Was it A, Geronimo? Or was it B, Crazy Horse? Or was it C, Sitting Bull? Or was it D, Black Kettle? The answer is A, Geronimo. Geronimo was the very last Indian warrior to surrender to the United States. And then he went on from there and became a celebrity, and he became world famous when he joined Buffalo Bill Cody's Wild West show in the late 1800s. And in March 1905, Geronimo even proudly rode his horse in Teddy Roosevelt's presidential inaugural parade in Washington, D.C. The very famous Apache Indian warrior, Geronimo, is buried in the Indian Cemetery at the U.S. Army's Fort Sill near Lawton, Oklahoma. Question 23. Which Western female outlaw lived in and hid out in Oklahoma Indian Territory? Was it A, Belle Starr? Or was it B, Anna McDulett, also known as Catalani? Or was it C, Jenny Stevenson, also known as Little Britches? Or was it D, all of the above? Or was it E, none of the above? The answer is D, all of the above. Belle Starr was a very well-known female outlaw, and most all of her friends were also outlaws. Belle Starr had a reputation for being a very tough woman, but on February the 3rd, 1889, when she was almost 41 years old, she was shot in the back and killed by a person unknown as she was returning to her ranch home near Briartown, Indian Territory, Oklahoma. The other two Indian Territory female outlaws was Cattle Annie and Little Britches, two young teenage girls who rode with the Bill Doolin gang, who were also known as the Oklahombres. Cattle Annie and Little Britches mostly just served as spies and lookouts for the Bill Doolin outlaw gang, but they were also good at stealing horses and selling whiskey to the Indians. But in 1895, they were both caught and sent to a woman's reformatory prison. Question 24. In which state or territory did the famous land run happen on April the 22nd, 1889? Was it A, New Mexico Territory? Or was it B, state of Kansas? Or was it C, state of Texas? Or was it D, Indian Territory, Oklahoma? The answer is D, Indian Territory, Oklahoma. Historians claim that it was total chaos and confusion on that day when approximately 50,000 settlers rushed in to claim their 160 acres of free land. And in the confusion, there were many people who were seriously injured or killed due to all kinds of accidents and even gunfights over land claims. And it's from that land run where we get the two terms, boomer, sooner. The Oklahoma boomers were those settlers who obtained their land legally, and the Oklahoma sooners were those settlers who cheated to get their 160 acres of free land by rushing in a day or two early and ahead of everybody else. Question 25. What was the famous Johnson County War fought over in northern Wyoming from July of 1889 to May 1893? Was it A, eminent domain and roadway rights? Or was it B, grazing grass and water rights? Or was it C, railway rights through ranch properties? Or was it D, telegraph wiring rights over private properties? The answer is B, grazing grass and water rights. The Johnson County War is sometimes referred to as the Wyoming Range War, and the whole conflict mostly all started when farmers and homesteaders started moving into the county and then being accused of cattle rustling by the large ranchers. And then the cattle barons started trying to deny the homesteaders and the farmers any grazing or water rights for their small herd of cows. And then the whole thing turned into a big mess with many bad confrontations and conflicts. And then it really got nasty when 52 cattle barons got together and hired 22 Texas gunslingers to come to Wyoming and clean up Johnson County. And then after several people were killed and houses had been burned down, the bitter four-year Johnson County War finally ended with some new land laws and a posse of 200 Wyoming lawmen. And when President Benjamin Harrison sent in the U.S. Army's 6th Cavalry. Question 26. Which outlaw gang attempted to rob two banks at the same time in Coffeyville, Kansas on October the 5th, 1892? Was it A, the James Gang? Or was it B, the Dalton Gang? Or was it C, the Younger Gang? Or was it D, the Doolin Gang? The answer is B, the Dalton Gang. During the attempted robberies of the two banks, a 12-minute gunfight ensued, and after it was all over, four of the five outlaw gang members were dead, including the gang leader, Grant Dalton, and his brother Bob Dalton, and two of the other robbers, Dick Broadwell and Bill Powers. And during that gunfight, three defenders were also killed, two citizens and Coffeyville's Sheriff Connolly. The only outlaw who survived was a very young Emmett Dalton, who had received 23 gunshot wounds, but somehow he lived, and when he was arrested, he was still clutching a very large bag of money that he had taken from one of the banks. And after being released from serving several years in prison, Emmett Dalton went on and lived a normal and law-abiding life. Question 27. Which Western outlaw killed a man for snoring too loud? Was it A, Grant Dalton? Or was it B, Jesse James? Or was it C, John Wesley Hardin? Or was it D, Cole Younger? The answer is C, John Wesley Hardin. There were many old Western outlaws, but John Wesley Hardin was one of the meanest, and he himself claimed to have killed at least 40 men, but he said that he never killed anybody who didn't deserve it. On August the 19th of 1895, another bad outlaw by the name of John Selman walked into the Acme Saloon in El Paso, Texas, and shot John Wesley Hardin in the back of the head and killing him instantly. And at the trial, the judge said that any man who could shoot John Wesley Hardin in the eye would be a good marksman, but any man who would shoot John Wesley Hardin in the back of the head would have good judgment. Question 28. Which lawman killed the outlaw gang leader, Bill Doolin? Was it A, U.S. Deputy Marshal Chris Madsen? Or was it B, U.S. Deputy Marshal Bill Tilghman? Or was it C, U.S. Deputy Marshal Heck Thomas? Or was it D, U.S. Deputy Marshal Wyatt Earp? The answer is C, U.S. Deputy Marshal Heck Thomas. On the night of August 25th of 1896, the outlaw Bill Doolin was visiting with his wife and his son near the small town of Lawson in Pawnee County, Oklahoma, when a posse of lawmen caught up with him and a brief gunfight ensued, and the 38-year-old outlaw was killed by a single shotgun blast that was fired by U.S. Deputy Marshal Heck Thomas. and afterwards they counted 21 buckshot holes in the outlaw Bill Doolin's body. Question 29. Known as the hanging judge, how many bad outlaws did Judge Isaac Parker hang in 21 years, from 1875 to 1896? Was it A, 63 outlaws? Or was it B, 73 outlaws? Or was it C, 83 outlaws? Or was it D, 93 outlaws? The answer is C, 83 outlaws. There were two very famous judges during the period of the old Wild West. There was Judge Roy Bean of Langtry, Texas, and then there was Judge Isaac Parker, or the hanging judge, at Fort Smith, Arkansas, who was probably the best known of the two judges because he hung many bad outlaws. Judge Isaac Parker showed no mercy when it came to having to execute a bad outlaw, and sometimes he would even hang six outlaws at the same time, and it was 13 steps up to the gallows, where the hanging nooses with their 13 coiled wraps were hanging over the trap doors and waiting. Judge Parker's executioner, George Malden, was once asked by a reporter if he was worried about any of the ghosts from all of those many outlaws who he had executed over the years. And George Malden said no, he wasn't worried at all, because he had hanged all of their ghosts with them. Question 30. Well known in the 1880s and 90s, who was Soapy Smith? Was it A, a lawman? Or was it B, a con man? Or was it C, a judge? Or was it D, a sheriff? The answer is B, a con man. His name was Jefferson Randolph Smith, but he was best known as just Soapy Smith, and he had several other swindlers who worked for him, and they called themselves the Soap Gang, and they swindled thousands of people out of their money and possessions, mostly in Texas and Colorado. But their nefarious scams, schemes, and luck all ran out on them on July the 8th, 1898. In Skagway, Alaska, when they tried to swindle a Klondike gold miner out of his sack of gold, and a gunfight broke out, and they say that Soapy Smith's last words were, "Don't shoot," and then a bullet went straight through his heart, killing Soapy Smith instantly at the young age of 37 years old. Soapy Smith's co-conspirators were then all arrested and put in jail, and that was the end of the old Wild West Soap Gang. Question 31. In the 1880s and 1890s, which outlaw was the leader of the Wild Bunch Gang, also known as the Hole in the Wall Gang, in Wyoming, Utah, and Colorado? Was it A, Robert Leroy Parker? Or was it B, Harry Longabaugh? Or was it C, Harvey Logan? Or was it D, Ben Kilpatrick? The answer is A, Robert Leroy Parker. But he was best known by his alias name, Butch Cassidy. The other three names listed here were also members of the Wild Bunch Gang, and there were a few others. The Wild Bunch Gang was very well known for bank robberies and train robberies in the late 1800s. Historians claim that Butch Cassidy never did kill anybody, but it's believed that the Sundance Kid killed at least 8 people during his life of crime. In 1901, Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid, along with the Sundance Kid's girlfriend, at a place, all fled to South America. Nobody knows for sure exactly what happened to the desperados after they fled from the law and went to South America, but the one thing that is for sure is that there has been no shortage of theories. Some historians believe that Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid were both killed in a gunfight with the Bolivian Army in San Vicente, Bolivia, in November of 1908. And other historians believe that all three eventually came back to the United States under new alias names, and they all went on to live a normal and law-abiding life. But the real truth may never be known and has been lost to history. Question 32. On December the 27th, 1900, which woman started her rampage against alcohol consumption and became very well known for destroying saloons with her hatchet? Was it A, Clara Barton? Or was it B, Harriet Tubman? Or was it C, Carrie A. Nation? Or was it D, Lizzie A. Borden? The answer is C, Carrie A. Nation. Carrie Nation was a very radical leader of the temperance movement, and she was arrested and put in jail on many different occasions for destroying saloons with her hatchet in Missouri, Kansas, and Oklahoma. She herself changed her first name from Carrie to Carry, Carrie A. Nation. And when she would go on a rampage against alcohol with her hatchet, she would call that hatchetations. And back in those days, there were many saloons that had a sign out front that read, "Everyone is welcome here, except Carrie Nation." Thank you for watching my 32-question quiz about the old American West. And if you made it this far, then that means you enjoyed it. So please, click on that thumbs up button. Thanks again, and goodbye.